In this virtual conference room, I recognize some familiar names of participants from governments, the private or NGOs. I'm sure we all are reaching out to many students, friends, practitioners, civil society representatives. A warm welcome to all of you. And now I introduce resource person Dr. Satyanarayan Gowda, who is from Hyderabad, and it is known as the City of Pearls. Rehabilitation therapist from Nipet, Secunderabad. Sir is author of 7 books on autism spectrum disorder and 2 books on intellectual disabilities. Sir has 10 years of experience in the field of disability rehabilitation. I request you to grace the occasion and share your views, sir. And welcome our second resource person, Dr. Ritvik S. Kashyap is from Mysore. The city is known as Garden of City, City of Palace, which is also famous for Chamundeshwari Temple. Sir is Assistant Professor of Clinical Psychology from the Department of Clinical Psychology, J.S. Medical College and Hospital, Mysuru. Sir is a member of Professional Affairs Committee, Indian Association of Clinical Psychology, Life Associate Member, Indian Psychiatric Society and Life Member of World Association of Psychosocial Rehabilitation. I welcome you all, sir. And I would be the third resource person for today's webinar. And I'm working as Assistant Professor and I am a Best Paper Awardee into 35th ISCP. And presented 14 national and 2 international papers and published 4 research papers. And now I hand over to Dr. Vidya Bhushan, sir, to welcome our resource person, sir, for continuing the webinar.
थैंक यू मैम. आपने आज हमारे जो डिस्टिंग्विश्ड गेस्ट हैं उनका स्वागत की बहुत वंडरफुल तरीके से किए. एंड नाउ सीआरसी सिक्किम अपने लक्ष्यों की प्राप्ति के लिए हमारे यशस्वी डायरेक्टर सर के निर्देशन में आगे बढ़ रहा है. विगत एक साल के अंदर सीआरसी सिक्किम के चारों डिस्ट्रिक्ट में अपनी किसी न किसी रूप में अपनी सेवाओं को दिव्यांग जनों तक पहुंचाने की कोशिश की है. अपनी सेवाओं को इफेक्टिव रूप से क्रियान्वयन करने के लिए पंचायती राज के लोगों, डिस्ट्रिक्ट एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन, दिव्यांग जन अधिकारी, सोशल वेलफेयर के साथ समन्वय बनाए हैं. इन सभी कार्यों के ऊर्जा स्रोत हमारे निर्देशक महोदय हैं, जो कि हमारे वेबिनार में भी आज जुड़े हुए हैं. मैं अपने निर्देशक महोदय सर से आग्रह करता हूं एवं आमंत्रित करता हूं कि वो इस वेबिनार में 2 शब्द बोले और हम लोगों का ऊर्जा वर्धक करें. सर प्लीज. सर
नमस्कार. आप सबको बहुत बहुत नमस्कार. सीआरसी की पूरी परिवार को बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद ज्ञापन करता हूँ. आप लोगों ने ऐसा भरिया प्रोग्राम काफी दिन से आप लोग कर रहे हैं, इसके लिए आप लोग बधाई के पात्र हैं. उससे भी ज्यादा बधाई आप लोगों को इसलिए मिलता है क्योंकि आज के जो रिसोर्स पर्सन 2 आप लोगों ने बाहर से उपलब्ध कराया है, डॉक्टर सत्यनारायण गौड़ जी और डॉक्टर रीति कश्यप जी, उन दोनों को मैं अपनी तरफ से नमन करता हूँ. और सर हम आशा यही करेंगे आप लोगों से कि आने वाले दिनों में आप लोग हमारे जितने नए नए सेंटर्स हैं, छोटे छोटे सेंटर्स है, इन सबके ऊपर आशीर्वाद अपना बनाए रखें. वॉलंटियर के रूप में, कंसल्टेंट के रूप में, जैसे चाहे आप लोगों को जैसा ठीक लगे, हमारे ऊपर आपका आशीर्वाद बनाए रहना बहुत जरूरी है. बिकॉज नेशनल इंस्टीट्यूट्स एंड सीआरसीज काम तो चल रहे हैं, हम लोग सब लोग काम कर रहे हैं, पिछले करीब करीब 20-30 साल से काम कर रहे हैं. लेकिन अगर मेंटल इलनेस सेक्टर की बात करें, मेंटल हेल्थ सेक्टर की बात करें, ओनली लास्ट 2-3 ईयर्स में ही थोड़ी सी हलचल हम लोगों ने शुरू की है, जब से हमारा नया नेशनल इंस्टीट्यूट ऑन मेंटल हेल्थ रिहेबिलिटेशन सीहोर में आया है. तो मैं बहुत गौरव महसूस कर रहा हूँ आप लोगों को यहाँ पाके, क्योंकि टॉपिक इतना अहम है, आने वाले दिनों में इसके ऊपर बहुत ज्यादा हमें काम करने की जरूरत है. तो आयरिश मैडम, विद्या भूषण जी, मनीष जी और स्पेशली हमारी रजनी मैडम को भी मैं धन्यवाद करता हूँ. मेरा जो अभिज्ञता रहा है वो थोड़ी सी कॉम्प्लेक्स टाइप का अभिज्ञता रहा है. एक तो जेनरिक मेंटल हेल्थ चैलेंजेस जो आम पॉपुलेशन में देखी गई, वो भी बहुत बड़ा चैलेंज देखी गई. रीजन बीइंग मैं कैंपस में रहता हूँ, 300-400 परिवारों का मुझे ध्यान रखना पड़ता है, तो जेनरिक पॉपुलेशन में भी बहुत भयंकर मेंटल हेल्थ चैलेंजेस वी हैव सीन. एंड व्हेन इट केम टू पर्संस विद डिसेबिलिटीज, दे फर्दर एडेड ऑन टू मेनी ऑफ दिस स्पेसिफिक चैलेंजेस इन टर्म्स ऑफ कोविड मेंटल हेल्थ चैलेंजेस. उसके बाद इन माई एक्सपीरियंस व्हेन आई स्टार्टेड डिस्कवरिंग दैट एज, टाइप ऑफ डिसेबिलिटी, सीवियरिटी, सोशियो इकोनॉमिक स्टेटस, family composition, family coping skill and the activities that the families were engaging during this period had a much, much greater impact on the overall dynamics of mental health of these people. Phir being at the National Institute, we realized that there are many, many factors which actually added upon to all these mental health issues. For example, food. For many of us, it was not a question, but for many persons with disability, even food was a question. Generic healthcare was a question. COVID care was a question. COVID vaccination was a question. Isolation of a person with disability for 2 to 3 days was a very big deal. Quarantining for 17 to 20 days was part of a very immenseful experience that we had to undergo. I don't want to waste much of your time by talking about my experiences on quarantining persons with disabilities, especially couples, both couples being blind, they have to be quarantined for say 17 days. So entirely different set of experience. We even underwent experience of cases of people waiting for blood transfusion. Thalassemia comes under our disability. So they called us up, they reached us, if you don't, I'm going to die. And everybody knows this. And we're not in a position during lockdown even for the blood supply properly. Drug supply for our normal clients, those who needed drugs definitely on an everyday basis, epileptic drugs, psychiatric drugs, many other drugs were regularly being given. That got impacted, therapy services got impacted, education, all of you know, only online, and online accessibility and online availability for persons with disabilities across the country is a very, very big challenge. Then skilling was halted because most of the skilling programs were practical based. Employment generation activities were put on hold. Entrepreneurship activities were put on hold. Economy for persons with disabilities got affected to a very large extent. And career prospects of persons with disability, because whatever reason it took a toll, now we are looking at during COVID and post-COVID digitalized world with new career options and new skilling options of persons with disabilities. Even I suspect normally the abuse factor in persons with disabilities is much more, whether it is psychological abuse, physical abuse or sexual abuse, it is much more prevalently in comparison to the regular population. But I doubt in this COVID time, this may have grown up to several times. And with our basic understanding of in the last 2 decades from just maybe 5%, I'm not very sure, maybe 5% in the last 2 decades, now we have gone up to around 25% of persons in generic population getting some kind of effect with regard to mental health. And due to this, we have launched this Kiran helpline also. But with that also, my experience was that the enormity of the problem is so much, and Kiran helpline or few CRCs or few NGOs, I really don't know what is the way forward. Once again, thanking the whole of CRC team and Satyanarayan Gorsar and Ritik Kashyap ji. Bahut bahut dhanyabad. Namaskar ji. Dhanyabad sir. Namaskar.
Dhanyabad sir. आप अपने व्यस्तता के बावजूद इस कार्यक्रम को संबोधित किए सर, आपका बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद। अब कार्यक्रम को आगे बढ़ाते हुए हमारे पहले
मैं सुनते रहूंगा सर, आई विल बी देयर, आई विल बी ऑनलाइन, आई विल बी लिसनिंग
सर। सर अपने पहले रिसोर्स पर्सन जिनका की टॉपिक है चिल्ड्रेन विथ डेवलपमेंटल डिसेबिलिटी, और इस टॉपिक के ऊपर प्रेजेंटेशन के लिए हम प्रथम रिसोर्स पर्सन डॉक्टर सत्यनारायण गौर सर को आमंत्रित करते हैं कि सर आप आए और अपना सर प्रेजेंटेशन से हम लोगों को बहुत सारी महत्वपूर्ण जानकारियां प्रदान करें। सर आपका बहुत बहुत स्वागत है सर।
थैंक यू विद्याभूषण सर फॉर वेलकमिंग। थैंक यू डायरेक्टर सर डॉक्टर हिमांशु दास। आई एम वेरी हम्बल इन फ्रंट ऑफ यू। I worked under you, and wherever you go, sir, you raise the flag of that institution, and no doubt that in under your charismatic leadership, the NIEPVD will flourish like anything, and NIMHR as well, and your contribution to Kiran Helpline, for which I am also coordinator for Telangana region, wonderful service, sir. Initially, we were not knowing where to start, where to end. But we came to a stage, sir, we can guide anyone on online counseling and all. For example, yesterday one boy was standing on railway track and called me. And, it is very proud to say that I sent him back and, I am following up that boy. It is all because of your blessings and your support from Director Lipid and Ministry. They are doing wonders. I think we will set milestones for future generations in this regard. And humbly, I thank everyone for inviting me. And I will start without time constraints are there. I will start my presentation on handling children. My counterparts will be dealing with the parents. So I will be dealing with children so that their handling will be, you know, not that difficult for parents. Hope you are able to see PPT.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
So, pandemic made you know, children to confined to their homes, not for 1 month, 2 months. It is for you know, more than a year, and we do not know what will happen in future. So I'll be sharing you some tips which I use at our National Institute, and which are, you know, proven to be quite effective dealing with the children at home. Basically, this procedure is restructuring. I'll be talking about the various issues, like how to engage them in indoor games and outdoor games, how to set up their, you know, study corner and all, how to go for hobbies, and what are all the exercises we can give them so that they will be very attentive. And I will be talking about basic therapies for ADHD and ASD that a parent can employ it. So coming to initially, we request parents for children with developmental disabilities to set up a corner, a study corner we can say, or, you know, play corner we can say. It should have a table and a chair, and their child will sit for some time and they will start working on the project we give, or, you know, homeworks or any school works, online school works, they can do it there. This corner should be very distraction free, and there should not be any TV or any neighbors coming and disturbing the child. And the corner should be, you know, like a sense of belongingness should be there. When child sits there, it is good to paste a photograph of that child there, and place any articles made by the child there. You can also paste the drawings made by the child, so that he will be encouraged to do more activity there. And start with the activity which child loves most. No need to force the child to sit there for longer duration. Particularly children with ASD and ADHD will be having very less tolerance. So we start with 5 minutes activity and a 15 minute break, and slowly, slowly we will be increasing the duration. And as the child progresses, we will be rewarding the child for appropriate behavior. And it is also wise to place any tokens if child is given, or any reward charts, like having stickers, smileys for doing the work, placed there. A chart can be placed there so that child will remember the task and the rewards he is getting or she is getting for the attainment of the task. And it is also advisable, you know, to keep the place neat and tidy. It should not be thrown here and there. Have a couple of boxes so that he can or she can pack the things and retrieve the things one at a time for the activity. So we can advise parents, we can you know, counsel parents to go for activities such as coloring activity. This will improve eye-hand coordination. Not only that, it will also improve attention span. A child can use variety of colors, like watercolors, crayons, and pencils. Pencils also, we have to give, you know, pencils with three sides. So tripod grip will be very easy. So there are no rules initially. Let a child go for scribbling. It is one. Then slowly we will be giving shapes, like circles, like, you know, a square and a rectangle. We can go for triangle, different shapes. When child starts circling with not within the circle, no need to get panic, because it takes some 20 pages to 100 pages, or some children will pick up it even more beyond that to achieve the eye-hand coordination. So to get it quickly, try to have a frame like a circle and you know, triangle and rectangle. Clip it to the clipboard. Put a paper behind and let the child use, you know, pencil or crayon. If there is any difficulty in using crayons and pencils, let the child go for you know water colors, let him dip his finger and go for coloring within the shape. Slowly remove the slides and you can give the difference.
Hello.
So going for you know different shapes, like you know triangle, rectangle, circle, and having slides for it, then slowly we will remove the slides, then they will go for you know independently circling the things. So eye hand coordination will be given. Once child starts coloring within circles and all, go for lot of coloring activity. Say like you can join four two circles and you can make a hand. You can join you know 7-8 circles to make it as a you know caterpillar. So likewise art therapy we can use during COVID times, so that child will be liking the you know work he likes, and he will also able to sit, and this will reduce the frequency of other problem behaviors basically. And playing with the clay, a lot of clay can be used, like you know making initially child will be sitting at his chair and table, he'll be playing with the clay. Clay can be purchased with you know very minimal amount, like 100 rupees you will get you know a good clay with molds. So child will be simply doing you know balls and all, then you will go for using the molds to make the butterfly. There will be different molds with the clays. You must have seen it will be available in bookstalls and all, you can get it. And when child starts using clay and enjoys, you can go for complex structures. This is also very best method. If poor child is there, this kind of you know different things can be made. Poor child is there, clay can be made with maida at home. Food colors can be added. After a few days it will become hard, it can be thrown out. And we can also use mud also to prepare this you know activity. And some structures, basic structures, the child can make blocks, he can use. So different activities we can plan. We can plan a week chart. In week chart, different activities can be given at different times. And I want to tell you here, see, the attention span of child is very less. We have to respect that. Let there be some time where child can be himself doing nothing also, right? So do not insist to do the things when child is in not appropriate mode, when he is irritable or you know not obeying. When you are in bad mood or you are in angry, you are irritable, then don't handle the child. Okay, let the child be himself. So when you are in good mood and child is in good mood, start the therapist. That is the key point. And I tell you, even we people, if you want to crack some higher examinations, you cannot read 10 hours in a day to crack some exam. Okay, 1,000 hours of effort is required. And if you put 45 minutes and 45 minutes of two sessions for that competitive exam, when your effort crosses 100 hours, you will be qualifying exam. When effort crosses 1,000 hours, you will be in top 10. And reverse engineering is the procedure. You will be solving multiple choice questions and related you know previous questions. So likewise, why I want to say this is, don't think that a child can be engaged you know 24/7. Let the child be engaged in two meaningful sessions with quality time, spending some 15 minutes of time to 30 minutes of time is a quality time. That is sufficient. Teach happily to the child and he will learn. They know our emotions, they know you know what you are feeling, most of them, and they will react appropriately, right? And they learn from you. A lot of indoor games can be played, and I give you a few examples like caroms. Child may not be able to follow the rules initially, it may take some time. So make it not complicated game like what you and me play. Play with you know just tossing the coins, and if siblings are there, let them play together. And you know while playing, all their original behavior will come. There you can go for corrections, you can also teach them sharing, turn taking, So caroms is the one I can recommend during COVID times. And you know, Ludo game is very simple one, and there will be a dice, and you know, throw dice. If you know, you get 2 points, 2 moves will be there. This is also wonderful game. And this caroms along with Ludo is available in market. I think 150 rupees with very less amount, we can teach wonders to the child. And indoor games like hide and seek can be taught, and initially start inside the home, then generalize with the children outside, right? And when you do it in COVID times, yeah, minimize the thing. When we come out of this, then go for a lot of group therapy. Initially start it at home. Yeah, outdoor games. We have to teach child outdoor games as well for socialization and you know, connecting to the world. Initially start with a simple ball. Simple balls of 20 rupees are available in the market. Say it looks like a balloon. When you know, blow it will you know, grow big size. You can play with the balloon also, but balloons are not steady. So this balloon like balls are very cheap. If you punch it will blast. So try to get them in traffic signal colors like red, yellow, blue, green, and start playing with the child. Initially, rolling will be preferred. Rolling the ball to the child, keep the distance very near, only 1 feet or 2 feet away, then roll the ball. If child able to catch, then ask the child to roll it back to you. If child is not able to do that, stand behind the child and let the child make it to push it towards you. So when he does, you have to applaud and give, you know, reinforcement like very good, nice, excellent, wow, wonderful, clap, you know, good smile, and all this will work. Have your, you know, different reinforcers at your disposal, and slowly increase the length to 6 feet, to corner of this room to you know, other corner of the room. And when child you know, start giving to and fro, then we can go for a one tap giving of the ball. So you throw the ball with one tap and it will reach the child. Child has to catch it, and he will again throw it to you, and you will catch the ball. So this is a basic thumb taking. It is wonderful, and when child starts doing it, enjoying it, add one more person. So three people will be in a triangle shape in playing together for quality time. When child is comfortable with, you know, playing with three people, add one more person. So four people are there. Now you can divide as a team. This is basic socialization. When child goes to school, he will play with, you know, group of people as well. Outdoor games like, you know, cycling and all, very wonderful things. Child will enjoy. So let them, you know, go for cycling, and how to apply brakes, we have to teach them. And don't leave the child, you know, just like that. We have to keep an eye on the child. And how to apply brakes is very, very important. There is a blind corner. If child goes this way and there is a, you know, straight road, and if something is comes from, you know, left side of the child, he cannot see. That blind corner concept, we have to teach to the child, and corners he will be riding very slow. Better to teach this in a park or open place. So when he is comfortable, then go for, you know, riding in outside. And hobbies like singing, dancing will be of fruitful nature. Let the child, you know, sing in whatever language he knows, and you know, even if it is, you know, not clearly audible to you, words are not proper, even humming will do. Dance is a wonderful therapy for not only children, for us also. It is a great stress buster. So the spatial intelligence will improve with, you know, dancing. So giving, you know, small steps, you know, left and right, show me a left, taking few steps, front and back, you know, swing your hands, simple aerobic exercises and all, we can teach the children with the music on the background, right? So handling, there are, you know, there will be endless list if I talk about, you know, what kind of games child can play. It is up to your creativity, your intuition and child ability. Select a variety of toys. There are age range classified toys in, you know, available in good stores, even online also, which is affordable to the parent. Try to get it and get it in your centers as well, so that age appropriate children can be taken care of. Yeah, handling hyperactivity is a very big challenge for parents during pandemic, because child is not able to sit at a place. So how come you will sit? There is an incident in Hyderabad city recent past, and we were all locked inside, and police are not allowing anybody outside. But one mother has to get a special permission from police that child cannot afford to stay at home. He every day he has got a routine. He is diagnosed as a severe ASD with ADHD features. Child has to go for a ride every day in his car, and he doesn't put on mask. So police are checking mask outside, and they are not allowing anyone. So she mother applied for police permission, and police also they were not bothered. They also took out their mask and stand very far and cooperated with the child. I think there should be some standard procedures during COVID. It should not happen that it will go on increasing, but for the special children, they should be given special permissions by default. I think Dr. Himanshu sir is there, and our charismatic leaders are there. They will look into this kind of matters. Anyway, handling ADHD will be very difficult task, and at home, of course, start with the diet. The diet works like anything. I've seen more than 1,000 patients. GMCF diet is a simple gluten-free, casein-free diet. We will not be giving milk to the child, milk products to the child who is very hyperactive, and we will also curtail sweets. We will not go for citrus to large quantities, and we will avoid kind of fruits which are rich in citrus, and we will also avoid fruits which are very sweet. We also drop wheat and wheat products. Instead, we will go for millets, millets flour, rice flour for preparing chapatis and all. And in vegetables, we will be dropping tomatoes, and some kinds of hybrid tomatoes will be having less citrus. That will be permitted if child likes only tomatoes. And we will also drop soya, because contrary to the earlier beliefs that it can replace milk, but in most children soya is causing hyperactivity. So we will drop those vegetable, soya and tomato. We'll go for lot of green leafy vegetables and dals. In dals, the tuvar ki dal and besan dal, that black chana, is in my clinical observation, and lot of mothers given feedback, are making child to become very hyperactive. So that also we will be curtailing, and junk foods we will be curtailing. Instead of junk foods, mama will be preparing at home snacks and all. And sometimes if hyperactivity is more, we have to take medications. Medication is child right. Since many times I listen from mothers and special educators that child is given medication by psychiatrist, and the child goes sleep. So we cannot teach them, and most of the time he is drowsy. See, it takes for a psychiatrist to adjust medication. Sometimes molecules have to be changed, and sometimes dosages have to be changed. It is clearly, and it is requested that you consult psychiatrist again, discuss this problem. They'll go for variation of medicine and dosages as well. With that also, attention span will increase, because brain plasticity is up to 6 years maximum. So of course, brain grows up to 21 years, and it attains its full capacity and neuronal functioning at 25 years of age. But first 2 years of age is very crucial. First, then 2 to 6 years of age is very crucial. That's why we intensify early interventions. Early intervention of any unit of any institute is heartbeat of that institute. If early intervention is taken care of, it will be, you know, the child will be, you know, coming to almost normal. So it has to be, you know, medication has to be started, then it is to be started. There are, you know, medicines, there are advances, there are neuroscience advances, psychiatrists going for phenoms, and I think, you know, modern medication will be, you know, balancing both activity and you know, hyperactivity of the child. And some exercises like sitting up exercises will also reduce hyperactivity. The activities I told earlier at the table will also reduce. Sit up exercises, what to do, child will be holding his ears like this, will go for, you know, sit down and sit up. Initially he will go down and go up. We have to teach it in, you know, very chunks, you know, small portions. While sit, when you say down, child will go down. When you say up, child will go up. So teach it in very, very small steps. So when child learns sit up and sit down, then breathe in and breathe out, we have to teach, and club together. When child has to go down, he will go down with the principle of hold of a cycle pump. When you pump a cycle downward, air will come out. But when child sits, no, he has to take air, breathe in. Okay. When child gets up, he has to breathe out. So he will sit in this position when you say sit, while breathing in, and while coming up, he has to breathe out. If you this has to be done 7 times, means 7 sit-ups, and maximum of 21 it can be done. It can be done 3 times a day. Don't go for more of it, right? And it has got a good effect on ADHD children, ASD children. You can prescribe this setup home as well. For ASD children, start with you know, eye contact first. You give all social skills, you know, emotions, reading, writing skills, whatever it is. But if eye contact is not made, all your you know, effort will go into vain. So start with, you know, eye contact exercises, like, you know, making bubbles. So a lot of time is there for mama and daddy and other siblings to play with the kid now. So bubbles are very interesting and child will be enjoying it. So ask mama to call the name of the child, particularly autistic children. Ask the child, there should not be any pet names. Please remember, the name which will be called by schoolmates should be used. Pet names to be dropped because child will be confused. Ask the name, ask the parent to call, everyone to call by name. And mother will be playing with the child with the bubbles. She will call the name. When child looks, she will blow the bubbles. And child will be enjoying with the bubbles. Then she will wait for a pause. He will anticipate. Then mama will again blow the, you know, bubbles, and the child will play with it. And this exercise can be 5 to 10 minutes. And in COVID, you know, who sells what, we don't know. So better to prepare bubbles at home. You can easily prepare bubbles with 20 rupees Vim liquid, or, you know, Dettol hand wash also good. So any dishwasher, you know, liquid will be very easy one, or shampoo is very easy one. It was initially very difficult for us how to prepare. We gone through the blogs. We were trying sugar, you know, etc., etc. But what is that? Glycerin and all. Make it very simple. Okay, what is available at home? Dish liquid is there. Dishwashing liquid, Vim liquid, and all. You get variety of things like pill. That can be added in the tube, you know, little, and water can be put, and when you shake it, you can use it for hours. By chance, child eats also, solution goes down, nothing goes wrong. Mama will prepare it again. So this can be done 3 times in a day. And when child starts, you know, looking at the face of mother, go for a little delay, little more delay. You know, that bubble stick should be, you know, placed in front of eyes in a 8 shape, and, you know, give a smiling face. Let child wait for, you know, 2 to 3 minutes, 2 to 3 seconds, 4 seconds and 5 seconds, then blow it. Right, increase the duration to 6 seconds. And eye contact exercise will be, you know, child, when child starts looking at you speaking, you know, little words, then make child standing somewhere, and he'll be, you know, standing facing wall. Okay, little distance to 6 feet to 10 feet away from you. You have to call the child name, and child has to turn back and say, "What? What, mommy? What, sir?" Like that. Okay, so have already have eye contact exercises. This you know, bubble one is very fruitful, and I am thinking to go for, you know, standardization of this therapy and patents. And exercise again, eye contact exercise is, you know, feeding the child, place the child in front of you at the table, and child will be facing face to face to the mother. At you know, parallel length, our child can be at a little bit higher, so that mama can you can easily see. Most of the aged children will be looking down, so we have to make them to look at us. So if child is sitting higher or equal to you, it will be easy. So mama will be carrying, you know, food, if like, you know, snacks which is liked by child most, like this, and will call child name. And that, as soon as child look at mama, she will feed it instantly. Okay, and say, "Wow, nice." And tickle, tickle. Again, she will take it, you know, a snack, and call mama, call his name. And when child looks into the mama's eyes, she will feed it. Very simple. So feeding will be, you know, can be 15 minutes to 30 minutes, some part 10 minutes. We have to request mother to be, you know, and other parents to be very patient and involved with this. With the food and bubbles, we can establish eye contact. Then we can teach, you know, verbalizations and all, social skills and all, reading, writing, everything will be very fast. That is my observation, right? And AADs will have, you know, speech deficits by default, and they will have 40% of them will be having seizure disorder also. Some genetic syndromes, 200 genetic syndromes will be having AAD. So IAD also nowadays has got a lot of AAD symptoms. So teaching speech also good exercise at home. There are 3-10 basic words. It chiefly range from the household items we use, and you know, market items, and shopping items like that. So basic words can be taught. Initially, child, you know, we take many of you may be speech therapists. Initially, child will be finger pointing the things of his own belongings. Then slowly we will generalize this, you know, to other items as well. So when child starts, you know, finger pointing, you can teach that, right? When child start speaking to you, there is wonderful therapy. Few words are learned by child, then we can go for MIT therapy. MIT is a Manchester Institute, an institute of technology in the US. They developed this. We have to show the item to the child. Say, "This is a pen," right? We'll ask child, "What is this?" Child will say, "Pen." Okay, we'll say, "Hi, pen." Very good. And you'll ask again, we'll say, initially, for to get accustomed with. Then start asking child, "What is this?" Child will say, "Pen." Ask again, "What is this?" "Pen." Again ask, "What is this?" "Pen." Okay. Again ask, "What is this?" "Pen." Then, "Wow, hi." So 3 to 5 times he has to child, then you go for reinforcement. This is also a wonderful one, and children will be, sibling will be having LKG, UKG books, colorful books, they are available plenty. Finger pointing can be taught taking child in the lap, right? And sharing of toys with the siblings and friends will be improving the social skills of the child, receiving others, saying namaste to them and saying bye bye to them. Slowly introduce. And we have NIPED publications. Website has got all of the publications there. Social skills publication is there, kindly get it. And Panchatantra stories also I recommend. At bedtime, child will be listening to the mama and will go sleep. पंचतंत्र इज क्लियरली रिटन फॉर चिल्ड्रन विद इंटेलेक्चुअल डिसेबिलिटी एंड डेवलपमेंटल डिसेबिलिटीज अर्लियर टाइम्स बाय इंडियन स्कॉलर्स सो यूज मेक यूज ऑफ देम देयर आर कलरफुल बुक्स इन पंचतंत्र गेट वन ऑफ देम आई रिकमेंड ओएम पब्लिकेशन 365 पंचतंत्र बुक दैट हैज गॉट एवरी डे वन स्टोरी यू कैन गो फॉर यू नो वॉट एवर यू फील कंफर्टेबल And thank you. I think I have done with kindly, you know, use mental health rehabilitation helpline, and kindly, you know, call us like the number is there 1-800-599-0019. Kindly call us whenever there is help and any guidance from our side. Thank you. Any questions you can ask.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir, for your wonderful presentation. Your slide. Is full of ideas to handling children with a developmental disability during COVID-19 and your idea in how to engage the children in the or different type of activity like outdoor games, indoor games will and other engagement in other indoor activities and outdoor activities will certainly help with having the sure therapeutic effect. So thank you sir for your wonderful presentation. Now I am requesting to all the participants that if you have any type of questions, please write in the chat box and our respected distinguished resource person will give the answer at the end of the session of this program. So there is also a short in the time. So without wasting our time, I requesting Dr. Ritvik S. Kashyap sir for the projecting the topic on reinvigorating mental health of the parents of children with disability during pandemic situation. So welcome sir, please continue with your topic and so that we and participants get the idea about how to handle the situations and how benefited by the how the persons will benefited during the COVID pandemic situation. Sir, welcome sir.
Thank you. So without wasting much of time, I'll be starting off with my topic, and I thank all the organizers for giving me an opportunity to talk to the august audience who are actually into the helping profession. So I would like to just you down some information about how are the parents of children with disabilities what are the problems that they are facing, and how we can help them to retain their mental health. So this pandemic has posed a serious risk to the well-being of every person, as we all know. So most of us are, if not physically affected, definitely we are all mentally affected and psychologically affected by this pandemic scenario. But those with disabilities, they are facing multiple threats because of the challenges they already had there in life. So now this pandemic has multiplied it in several times. And being a parent or a caregiver of a child with a disability, it has its own daily challenges. And now, as I was again saying, it has multiplied it now, because we have to adapt to a lot of new normals. That's what we are coming up with a new term as COVID adaptive behaviors, like wearing a mask or social distancing and all such the new kind of COVID adaptive behaviors that are coming as a new normals. So we have to adapt to these things, and making a child to adapt or making a person with disability to adapt to these kind of a new normals is a very hard task for a parent to get into the scenario. So I'm not making it very specific to any kind of a mental illness or developmental disabilities. Rather, I'm keeping the whole lot of disabilities in mind, and the parents of children with any of these disabilities in mind. So as we are all aware, so now the number of disabilities has increased from 7 to 21 with RPWD 2016. Let us just have a quick look into the statistics now. As we all know, the dearth of this issue is very high, and we have almost 1.5 crore male population and 1.18 crore female population in the disability sector. And out of that, almost 60%, 69% of them are in the rural areas, and 31% of them are in the urban areas, which makes it more difficult for the persons with disability to reach out to any kind of a service or the tertiary care sector or such kind of a higher facilities. So this is the scenario of disability in Indian scenario. So let me continue with my topic of today. Like, what about the parents of persons with disability? So now, parenting of children with disability. So there are millions of special needs children. So, but both of them, them and their parents, are still on the edge of social concerns. So they are definitely in need of the social concern, and they cannot do it. They cannot handle it on their own. So having a special needs child refers to a long-term challenges for parents, no matter what type and degree of disability the special needs children they have. So whenever there is a special child, even when it is born, there are a lot of challenges that the parents have to face with. Now, it may start off from the mother getting a divorce from the husband because she gave a birth to a special child, or she gave a birth to a child with some kind of a disability. From there, the problem starts. From there, the mental health issue starts for any of the parents. So starting off from that, how they would have to cope with the things, what are the challenges, what is that they have to understand about this disability or the special ability that the child has. So a lot of these kind of apprehensions will come into the picture, which definitely makes it as a very long-term challenge for a patient. And they experience a kind of a more and more of a physical, social and emotional challenges when it is compared to the parents of typically developing children, I mean the normal children. So definitely when we say, okay, the parents have to rear a child with cerebral palsy, they need to be more strong physically to lift the child, make the child sit, walk the child, carry the child. So there is a lot of more and more of challenges that they have to face physically and socially. Every time they take their child out, one or the other person randomly asks for what happened to your child. So that is very much very, very intriguing for any person to encounter these kind of question frequently and answer these things very frequently. It is very painful. And the emotional challenges. So this adding on to the social challenges, the emotional challenges that they themselves go through whenever they see a normal child playing along well, when my child is not able to play along in the same way. So this adds on a lot of an emotional challenge to myself, and the frequent taunting by either from the husband or from the wife's side or from the in-laws or from the neighbors. These kind of a frequent taunting, okay, fine, they have got a disabled child or they have got a special child. Then nobody called, even though we have been trying a lot from our end to make it destigmatized, the stigma is still there, and we do not see people calling Divyangjan, or we do not see people calling them a special child. They do still utilize the word differently. They even don't use the word differently, but they still use disabled. So that is a scenario which every patient encounters day in and day out, which makes it a very difficult challenge for parents to handle. So when it comes to the psychological impact of parenting children with special needs, so this is the short term I will be using, CWSN, which we are all very much aware of, the children with special needs. So these parents, they have a lot of they face a lot of psychological impact while parenting them. So they face a greater risk of psychological burden and experience various mental health problems such as majorly anxiety, depression, and marital discord, as I was already telling. So there is a lot of divorces that has been filed in the courts because she was not able to give birth to a normal child. They gave birth to a specially abled child and disabled child. So this kind of marital discord has been happening. And they experience a lot of sleep problems because of the sleeping routine of the child, and also because of their own mental health disturbances that is caused while trying to parent the child. They may display severe, diverse types of mental health problems. However, majorly the anxiety and depression are the most common mental health disturbances that we have encountered among the parents. So if we have to look at what are these predictors of mental health of parents with children with special needs, so basically it comes from the overall scenario of a society, economy, personal and psychological, and from all the sides, it is very much important to understand what will actually impact on their mental health. So as we can see, these are the major factors like economic and social status, the unemployment and the parenting stress, the children's their own behavioral problems and the lack of social support. So these are studied to be the major predictors of mental health of parents with children with special needs. So I will be just going slightly in detail into these problems. So if I have to go to the economic challenges, parents of special needs, as we all know, they have to continuously seek for a more special treatment, like some kind of a physiotherapy, some kind of an occupational therapy, some kind of vocational training, some kind of rehabilitation, some kind of psychotherapy for their children and for their for themselves, and then speech therapy. So they have to undergo a lot of these kind of rehabilitation facilities, which is sparsely available in most part of India, and they have to travel to different locations. Maybe even as per my idea, they would minimally not from those people who are in the major cities, but those people who are in the rural areas, they may have to travel a minimum of 50 to 100 kilometers to reach out to a specialization center or a center with such kind of a proper rehabilitation facilities. This is a dearth that we have in Indian scenario. And they have to reach out to these kind of a special care setups, and they have to go in for buying of these medical equipments, like even the hearing aid or just a wheelchair or even the prosthetics and all these kind of an equipments that they have to buy, and educational services wherein they have to look out for the special education centers, the co-education centers and the inclusive education centers. And this is certainly is going to cause a much more than the pocket size of the parents. It is definitely taxing on for the parents, which makes it again a burden for the parents. In the meantime, one of the parents should always be the main caregiver for the special needs child, which may cause an overall decline in the family's ability to work and reduce family income. Yes, we all know that either father or the mother has to stop working and has to be there as a whole time, as a full-time caregiver for the children with special needs. So we are all very, very well aware of this fact. So now this would also add on. So like in the other scenarios, like wherein both the father and mother would go ahead and try to make an earning for their life and try to balance the demands and everything, these parents will not have any other, will not be able to do this because one of them have to stay back along with the children with special needs. So that will again cause a much more demand on the only breadwinner, whoever is trying to earn for the family. So this has been one of the paper articles which I had recently seen, that COVID has caused around 77% parents of disabled children to lose jobs and 90% to depend on government support. So this was published in December 18, 2020 in one of the e-newspapers. So this has been carried out in from four states of South India. So this would really give us an idea as to how much exactly we are facing the problem. So now coming to the social status. So parents of special needs children would most often end up experiencing poverty because of two things. One is the lower economic and social status. They will not be, even though whatever that the money they would be having, even though they were able to afford things for their child, having the children with special needs definitely put them one step down from what exactly they are, even though they are economically sound enough. As I was already discussing the unemployment as compared to their counterparts as in the parents of the normal children. So the unemployment is also another cause which causes social status, and these things will definitely exacerbate mental health problems. We are very well aware of facts that poverty, lower economics and social status and unemployment are directly related to the mental health disturbances. So now coming to the next area, that is the behavioral problem in children with special needs. Now, so as we all know, these children with special needs, they pose serious behavioral and emotional problems, and the pressure to raise such children is the main challenge for parents. So dealing with these kind of a behavioral problems is another major challenge. So compared to typically developing children, that's the normal children, special needs children are more likely to exhibit externalizing behaviors and also internalizing behaviors in very few of the disabilities. It is more and more of an externalizing behavior which is most often seen. And there is difficulties in communicating and poor social relationships, wherein the child would be able to develop some kind of social skills. That is also lacking here because of their poor social relationships and also of oppositional defiant disorders, which makes it more difficult for the parents to take the child out and make them play along with other children. Such kind of a difficulties makes it more challenging for the parents, and not being able to make them child involve into the regular scenario or the regular social situation is adds on to their depression and adds on to their mental health disturbances, adds on to their guilt. So now coming to behavioral problems and parenting stress, the range of serious behavioral problems continually strengthen the parental stress and trigger parents into a poor mental health cycle. So, like, they'll not be able to carry out a proper routine for themselves. They'll not be able to even sit for a while and relax while they have to take care of any of these children with any of their behavioral problems. Even the frequent regulatory problems of children, such as the sleep problems or their improper diet or picky eating behaviors, or these kind of we will have to feed them whenever they want, or otherwise they won't eat, and we don't know when they will come and ask for us to feed them, and all these kind of irregularities in the daily routines also worsens the mental health situation among parents. Now coming to the social support, studies have reported that social support was an important factor for reducing parenting stress and prompting their ability to cope with mental health problems. So social support has been considered as one of the major good prognostic factor. But unfortunately, parents of special needs are often excluded from society and public concern, even though positive attitudes of raising special needs children among parents is always related to more social support. So if there is more social support from the community, from the village that they are in, or from the sect that they are in, it has to begin from there as to how they are supporting the parents to parent these children with special needs, and that will definitely enhance their mental health. Now these risk factors strengthen mental health problems among parents of special needs children. Now coming to the mental health of parents of these children during the pandemic. So now we had seen whatever that I was discussing now was a usual scenario. So now you can just imagine what and all has happened to these scenarios during the pandemic. We do not have people around. We do not have the facility to go out. We do not, and again, whatever the economic conditions of the parents that was already at stake is at more stake now. And whatnot. The social status, nobody is cared about the social status now, because it is more about the health. It is more about the health and it is more about safety now. So nobody is bothered about the social status. However, it is still has the influence over for procuring any kind of facility whenever they want to reach out. So now I would be just quoting a study which was done in China during this COVID-19 pandemic. So that was specifically, the title of the paper was Mental Health of Parents of Special Needs Children in China during the COVID-19 pandemic. So this was published in 2020. So I am just quoting a few findings from this paper. So now, parents of children with autism spectrum disorder were more likely to have mental health problems compared to parents whose children had an intellectual disability or a visual or hearing impairment, mainly because of social distancing, mainly because of the limited social element that we could bring into the autistic children for rehabilitating them or try to helping them out of the conditions. So behavioral problems of children and psychological demands of parents were common factors predicting mental health of all parents. And as I was saying, the parents-child dysfunctional interactions and parenting distress were associated with parents of children with autism spectrum disorder. So now, because of our own stress that we are undergoing, because of our own limitations and the psychological distress that we are undergoing during the pandemic, so this is causing a lot of problems in how we are interacting with the normal children only. So now when we are instructing our child, how we are instructing them to get onto the class or join their online classes or any of these things. So now the way we are interacting with the child has changed. Now we ourselves are frustrated, and the way we are instructing the child. Getting on to the next point, family support. For having a difficult child and parenting distress were associated with having children with an intellectual disability. So family support was very much felt to be necessary to tackle the parenting distress. And it is necessary to pay attention to the parents' mental health and to provide more social and family support and reduce parenting pressures were found to be the major findings of this study. So taking it forward, what we can do to promote mental health for parents of children with special needs. So now the main task is to balance both the child's mental health and the parental mental health. So what we have, what we can do, how we can ensure both. So we just have a 8-point formula over here which can be utilized. So first is to monitor. What we have to monitor? We have to monitor the child's feelings and also monitor our own feelings. I'll be coming to that later. So monitoring the child's feelings. So understand the disturbances when the child is having a behavioral problem, what they are actually throwing temper tantrums for, what they are comfortable with, what they are not comfortable with. So we have to monitor this child's feelings to understand what is happening with them. There is no other way where you can actually make sense out of what is happening to the child. It is only through behavioral observation or through monitoring. Then once you understand what the child is facing the problem with, like the child is not able to recognize the face of his or her father or mother when they enter from the outside wearing a mask and everything. So they are not able to recognize, so they are not able to greet, and they are considering them as some outsiders. So they are not able to recognize. So this is one of the new normal. So continuing with the next point. So once we understand that what exactly is the feeling, that uncomfortable feeling that the child is facing. So once we monitor and them understand, next we have to go ahead and help them to understand what exactly is that they are not comfortable with and how it is necessary in the language or in the method that they understand. So that is one thing that which can be helpful for to control their emotional changes or their to control their outburst of temper tantrum, so that when we make them understand that this is the need of the hour, or this is how we have to modify and this is why it is necessary, we have to make them understand in a way that they will be able to understand. Okay, so then we have to try to keep up with routines. So children like with the autism spectrum disorder and kind of intellectual disability and these kind of a mental illness and these things, children get used to a kind of a routine. So when these routines are disturbed, they obviously get into some kind of emotional disturbances. So this is one which is needed to take care of the balance, child's mental health also. And keeping up with the routine is very much essential for every individual, so that this will help us to have a proper routine in our both the food intake or the sleep and the hygiene, the physical exercise and everything. So we have to try to keep up with the routines. Then spending. Now spending, we are not talking about the money. We are talking about some time outside each day. Outside, I mean to say, whatever that is possible, just outside home or just even in the balcony or just even in the roof of, if you just go upstairs, that's on the rooftop of your house or the apartment or anything. So you have to just spend some time with the child outside of the four walls. So these four walls, we are bound to these four walls, and the children are, we ourselves are not able to sit within these four walls, and the children with special needs will not be able to cope up with that continuous. This is kind of a modern asylum treatment that we are getting now, being locked up in our own houses. So it looks like a modern asylum now. So we are bound to our own four walls. But this restricting us, but we ourselves have to restrict us to stay back at home. So now next thing is to there is social distancing that has been preferred as one of the measures to keep ourselves safe. But I would rather restate it as we need to maintain a physical distancing and we need to continue to have a social distancing. Like now I am reaching out to you people in various parts of India, sitting at Mysore and Karnataka, and now I am trying to be a part of the event in Sikkim. So this is how we have to stay connected virtually. So now this is the time where you can just make out a call to someone. Like you didn't find time to reach out to anyone, now you have time. So reach out to someone, just call up a relative and try help the child to talk to them, and you also talk to them, have some time and stay connected virtually. And then model behavior and coping skills. So now we have to show the behavior and coping skills to the child. Now, whenever I go out and come home, what are the behaviors that I need to carry out, like washing hands and keeping the clothes aside, or washing the clothes immediately, or these kind of behaviors, what I have to do, we have to model them. So we have to model the children. Okay, fine. Now we are coming inside the house. Now let us both go and let's both wash the hands, so that when we model the behavior, the child will follow us and will not be having a problem every time to scold them whenever they get inside. You have to wash hands, you have to wash hands. And for that, they will make a ruckus of it. This wouldn't be necessary when we model the behavior and coping skills to them. So if something is happening, there is some problem, how we have to cope with it, that also we have to model them. These are children whom we cannot make them understand. This is only with the modeling we will be able to teach them the skills. Then very important, taking care of yourself, as in I'm referring to the parents. So taking care of themselves for the parents is very important. So they have to, if they themselves have any kind of a problem, if they themselves are having any kind of problem, like even physical problems or mental problems or any of those things, so they need to ensure that they are having their regular medications properly, they are seeking their treatment is on properly, and taking care of themselves properly, both physically and mentally. So then we need to prioritize what works for your child at home. So now this is very important. Like, okay, fine. If I have to involve everyone at home, and if I have to sustain the mental health of everyone at home, what could be those kind of activities? Like, okay, fine. Making everyone sit together at once and just playing some Ludo, or just playing some business, or economy, or any of these kind of monopoly, or any of these kind of even housey, so which the child can involve and along, and we have a good time together. So this is what something which is very much important to sustain the mental health of the whole family members. Now, coming to the parents, who has to balance between the parenting, the employment, and the family and whatnot. So we have to prioritize self-care. So now when we are juggling between the work, school and family, now we have to prioritize our own self-care, and we have to be flexible for the changes that is happening. We do not know how things would cross our roads. So this is something that is totally, we do not have any idea about. So we have to be very flexible to adapt to changes that comes as and when into the routine. So definitely we need to have a routine to be stable and be functioning emotionally strong and physically strong, wherein we have to be flexible with whatever that comes into our across. So now we have to set, as I said, we have to set clear boundaries, practical boundaries, and not to burden up too much into yourselves to finish up tasks and other things. You have to stay in the loop and have a support system. So basically, I would just like to give out a small acronym that is stay strong. So S is, so they need to sleep adequately, take your medicines regularly, restrict excessive usage of any kind of drugs, including caffeine or tea, and one good deed to feel good about. Okay, fine. This is one thing I made the child learn, but I feel good about it. And the nutrition, have your food regularly, do not skip any lunch, breakfast or anything, and get regular exercises. This is one of the basic things that you have to do on a regular basis to keep yourself strong and also keep yourselves away from negative emotions and psychological disturbances. So this is the message to the parents and each and everyone part of this meeting. You're not alone in the process, and various national organizations and associations have set up helplines. So we have Kiran, which has been set up by the Government of India, and we have Mental Health, Ministry of Health and Family Welfare and Immense Initiative, support center is there. And we have also have Paramarsh, which has been set up by Indian Association of Clinical Psychologists. These are all centers are there, which has been helping in multilingual scenario for patients wide across the nation. So take any or take seek help from any of these initiatives and try to ensure your own mental health. Now, how we can turn the challenges into opportunities? The pandemic, it has given us the very important thing, the time. So which we lacked all the while. We all the time, okay, we didn't have time to speak to the child. We didn't have time to play with the child. We didn't have time to call up someone. Now this pandemic has given us that time, which we lacked all the while. So we have to make efforts to observe and understand the child and their special needs. So what they will respond to better, what they are comfortable with, what they're not comfortable with. Make efforts to self-monitor your own emotions, thoughts, and behaviors. Understand that you are frustrated. Observe that you are frustrated or observe that you are also undergoing stress. You are also undergoing those kind of disturbances. You need to self-monitor yourself before you react to anything. So date with yourself to safeguard your own mental health and physical health. Have some time for yourself. Do not assume that you are a superman or you have to assume a superman or a superwoman role. You cannot do everything. You are also a human being. We are also a human, normal human beings. We have our own limitations. So we have to understand that. And if we do not consider our own limitations, we will just burden up ourselves, which will definitely impact on our mental health. And keeping the own age old element of, I'm the cursed to have a child with special needs. No, you are not the cursed one. So you are one among us, all the parents and all the people who are here. You are saying that you are one among us and we are there to help. Virtual platforms like this have made us to reach to the professionals very easily. So that is one of the advantages that we have got. Now the people who had to travel minimum 50 to 100 kilometers to reach out to some professionals, now they can reach out to them virtually online and seek help. Ultimately, resilience and social support is the key for sustaining mental health. So with this, I would like to conclude my talk. Thank you for the time. So if the audience have any questions, you can drop it in the chat box. We will be able to address it later.
Thank you, sir, for your wonderful presentation. It's a high time to change the mindset of the society that the Bangan also have a right to lead the quality of life. And in such initiative, CRC Sikkim is also committed to provide therapeutic facilities in the form of PT, OT, speech and hearing, clinical psychology, vocational training, a specialist education to the Divyangjan. Thank you, sir. Again, thank you for the wonderful presentation. And now our last resource person is from the CRC itself, Dr. Tenali Rajini Bhushan, ma'am. So I am requesting ma'am to please give the brief presentation of the program, that is the well-being during the pandemic, psychological PPE. So welcome, ma'am. And please continue with your presentation.
Good evening, everybody, to the speakers who have already spoken about and also to the dignitaries present today. I'm going to talk about well-being during pandemic. I'm going to talk about psychological PPE, which I'm going to discuss about it. I welcome everybody to this mental health during pandemic for PWDs. Contents for this today's presentation is going to be on how to be positive of getting a positive report. So that is something very, because we were always waiting for whenever we think of getting any negative, we used to feel like, oh no, why did I get negative? But I think this is the only first statement. We are so happy about it. Getting a, how to get negative is something we are more happy about it. These are the content which I'm going to talk about. I will not be covering the aspects which Dr. Satya Gaud sir and Dr. Ritvik sir has actually spoken about. I'll be quickly shifting out with the other few aspects which are not being dealt about. I'm going to talk about psychological phases of COVID-19 and Maslow's hierarchy needs apply to teaching during the COVID-19 and how to normalize psychological responses who are on work, who are dealing with the clients on their day-to-day work. And the new term that's called new normal, how to find out your own new normal, and COVID hygiene, which I'll be not talking about it, and teaching mindfulness to children, and the term called psychological casualties, and psychological PPE and the other further things. I'll go to the next slide. Previously, when there was no, this I'm talking about pre-COVID days, and now during the lockdown days, People used to say that I don't have time for my family, but now you have a lot of time for your family. So previously used to say that occupational stress bahut hai, traveling bahut karna padta tha, family ke saath time spend na karta tha, internet addict ho gaya, but now we are using the mobile internet technology in such a wonderful way. We are able to utilize it in such a way that everybody has become very much tech savvy. And the research says previously there were a lot of sites which are about pornography sites, but nowadays the research states that everybody is checking out the health news and how to take care of how to build immune system. That is what all these about. And what is happening around the globe, only the people who were using mobiles were aware about, but now it is not only people are using mobiles, it's everybody is able to understand what is happening in and around the world. Previously what happened was like people were thinking like, I'm not bothered about I'll be getting COVID, especially in India. They were thinking in a denial phase that I do not want to accept. That is defense mechanism we talk about. But now everybody, after we have seen in the second and third phase, we can see that people are becoming health conscious and trying to maintain the COVID etiquette. And the pre-COVID days, like cooking was something only chef used to do, or only it was like saying that males do not cook or something like that. But now cooking is a recreational activity. Cooking skills are being explored by all the genders, both the genders. And domestic violence, FIRs and couple separation was more. But now during the lockdown, what we have seen is the couple counseling is being done and they're trying to stay under the same roof and trying to understand each other, trying to help each other how to handle their resolving, how to resolve the conflicts. And previously, whenever कभी कोई बोलता था आप कैसे हो, मैं तो ठीक हूँ, मुझे क्या हो गया. अगर अब nowadays जब ये lockdown में अगर कोई पूछा है आप कैसे हो, that itself gives a very kind of good sense. Oh, somebody is caring for me. आप कैसे हो, take care of your health. Those are the words which are really needed as a human psychology, because we are all dealing with emotions. So people have understood the importance of emotional balance. And trying to exploitation was more in the previous COVID days, and now the exploitation has reduced and people started having a lot of charities, like trying to, everybody is trying to be a very good person, trying to donate food, trying to donate food to the animals and also give to the human beings. And whenever there was a social stigma, previously people used to think that social stigma, like counseling, kya main pagal hoon, why should I go to a psychologist, why should I go to any psychiatrist. But now during the COVID lockdown days, people are understanding the importance of counseling and the decrease of social stigma when it is connected to the mental health. And previously, time was not that managed by many people. They were completely restless, the same time for everybody. But how do you manage is more important. Managing time was learned only during the lockdown days. And the other aspect is wife and husband, there is always, there is a fight between each other, saying that housewife keeps saying that I am, main subah se leke bacche ko pura behavior acha sikha rahi hu, sham ke time husband jab aate hai office ke baad mein, husband kya karte hain, he will try to pamper the child. To aise mein mother jo subah se unhone mehnat kiya hai child ka behavior sikhane ka, suddenly father aane ke baad jo pamper karte hain, to mother aur father mein wo jo conflict hoti hai ki I am teaching the good behavior and I am teaching the good behavior. But this lockdown days has given a very wonderful opportunity, like the couple together are understanding the child's behavior, how to go together, how to help each other to make the child have a very good health. And I'll not go in detail. Previously, there were a lot of terminology about oxygen related fever and oxygen level. It was not aware for everybody. It was just a terminology used by medical people or paramedical. But now each and everybody is aware about what is health, what is hygiene, how to handle, how to take care of cold, how to take care of everything. And also food was luxury previous days. Jaise ki mujhe biryani khana hai, I wanted to have good clothes, I want to have a party and all that. But the COVID lockdown days, think about the positive aspect. Abhi sab, now everybody is thinking that I can manage with whatever I have. I have to survive. I have to be healthy, I have to survive, not I don't need to have only luxurious foods and not only for the parties. So these are the positivity aspects. And now I'm going to talk about psychological phases of COVID. which is been by Jennifer Johnston in 2000. The image might not be clear. The psychological phases says pre-disaster impact, honeymoon and delusion and creating a new life. These are all existing. Maybe this will be more theoretical for the psychologist. But what this psychological phases talk about COVID is what we can do. Trying to limit news is something which is research proven, and create structured routines of your eating habits, of your entertainment habits, about your employment. Try to have a structured routines. Do not mix up with all your routines, thinking that I can eat and I can do my work and I can sleep and I can also listen to the music. Don't try to mix up one activity another activity. And having a play schedule, trying to have a particular play schedule for everybody, will be able to understand this is my play time. In spite of being at home, it is very much necessary, as Dr. Satya Gaur sir and Dr. Ritvik were saying just now, having proper schedules and having a beautiful arrangement of sitting place is something very important. Lockdown days is for Indians or around the globe. It has never changed our human mentality, because we are all dealing with emotions. We are all seeking love. We are all seek kindness and emotion and empathy. Marriages are happening. We are trying to recollect our own parents, grandparents, recollecting our memories. We have not gone, office has not stopped. We are trying to enjoy each and every aspect. This slide is talking about the different masks which are being developed and what kind of people are able to adjust in spite of lockdown, in spite of COVID. How can we adjust? We usually think COVID has given such a negativity. I mean, of course it is there, but we need to also accept that the life is not going to stop here. It's going to extend. I mean, we are going to live further. Every activity, every daily skill has been monitored and been taken care of. Everybody is taking care about it. Now, I'm talking about video telephoning is something which is started in 1910, which is actually depicted in 1910. This is the slide which is talking about, and 1930, and now the lockdown days, which is called video telephony, it's still happening. It is not that we are only temporarily for this. We have to accept this is only for a temporary phase. And I'm going to talk about the fulcrum, which talks about jo balance karta hai apne life mein, something which is called as fulcrum. So everybody has the negative thing and the positivity. How to overcome the negativity and how to improve our positive outcomes to have a better life. In that, we need to have responsive relationships. Who is playing a very beautiful relationship? It can be a brother, it can be your sister, it can be your mother, it could be a father, it could be a teacher, it could be anybody. Let us all have a beautiful supportive relationship, which is going to help us have a very positive outcome of the present situation. And how we are all aware about Maslow's hierarchy needs theory. Now, how this can be applied for the teaching curriculum, especially for the children in the regular schools. We always wonder to children, how is it happening? We need to understand, are students really safe? Are they fed on time? Do they know they are being loved and missed? Do they have coping skills to deal with their crisis and emotions? Do they have access to instructional material? That could be anything. It could be craft or it could be educational, but do they have the appropriate material? It is not just having a video call and just teacher is talking to the child, but as a teacher is how Maslow's theory can be applied. This is given by Spansbow High School. Skills for online remote learning, how this can also be used. And now I'm going to talk about psychological responses for the people who are actually in work, for doctors, paramedics, and even the nurses. It is okay not to be okay. We have to accept that sometimes we all will be having certain ups and downs in our lives. Experiencing symptoms of stress doesn't mean that you are, you're having issues. It means that you are a human being and you need to express. And in that, the staff permission to setbacks and ensure breaks and having rest on and off, understanding coping mechanism between each other is very much important. And speak to any of your close by practitioner, clinical or a rehabilitation psychologist. They're always there online, which Kiran has been promoted. So trying to connect everybody in every state, Kiran is something which is giving a very good connectivity to everybody dealing with mental health aspects. And the new normal is something which I'm going to talk about. Many people are these days during lockdown days are trying to understand that coping, probably taking alcohol, taking drugs, excessive sleeping, or other negative coping behaviors, trying to avoid that. So have a very good positive coping skills. And whenever you are having a screen, which is your school or your office or something, try to have breaks, move around, shift your gaze, even for 5 seconds, 5 minutes, take a break. Your eyes need rest, take a break and then do it. Try to have some snacks and just a break. Trying to listen to any of your favorite musics and create a schedule. What to do, how to do. It's not like since I'm in the home, many people say, I'm in the home, okay, I can do it later, I'll do it later. Never procrastinate things. It is always necessary for us to have a proper discipline. Discipline is something which makes our overall mentality about how to deal our own perspectives in life. And space and trying to have a binge watch. Binge watch is something like we keep on checking internet for a long time. Try to have gaps. Okay, I can see, I have seen, check enough. Try, you have to have your own stops. And COVID hygiene, I would not explain about it. And this is about Dr. Satya Gowda has already spoken about. So I would like to skip this slide about the children, how to, and never use hyperbolic languages, especially talking to the children, plague and something where they get, they have a fear. So teach them, don't repeat or share unconfirmed rumors about it. And don't show negative behaviors against airline crew members or something like that. Don't make false promises. Don't make the conversation scary or fear-based. Make them understand that how this can be coped with, how everybody is able to follow it. And the disabilities also, which has been already told about. I would like to share only about the review of literature. People living with visual disabilities are more likely vulnerable to get contracted from the severe acute respiratory syndrome than other people without visual impairment. I would like to not to focus more about it, but the personal safety rules are very much important to teach the children, because what we actually see is abused. Children who are sexually abused, nowadays children during the lockdown are also being abused. So it is always responsibility of the parents to teach them what is safety rule, what is uncomfortable touch, what is uncomfortable gesture, what is a language which is giving them, you know, a kind of messages which are not good. So teaching children about giving infographic symptoms about what is COVID, how to handle it, giving them some activities will make them involved in and let them have something where they can understand the subject and how to take care about themselves. Teaching mindfulness, which also been talked about. And I want to talk about psychological casualties. It is stated that can't do what they need to, absolutely need to do activities for daily living. We are not able to do any basic things. For example, going out, eating or doing anything. We are not able to do. This is something called as psychological casualties. What we need to do for the children, especially adaptive emotional skills are very much important. When we see the children, they learn from the parents. So authoritative communication and the personal protective equipment which is talking about. So take a day off and create a space between work and home life. Avoid publicity and media coverage about COVID-19. Receive mental health support. Facilitate opportunities to show gratitude. Reframe negative experiences as positive and reclaim the agency. This has also been individually and the team in a working place. Limit staff and design clear roles and leaderships. Make peer support services available to staff and trying to the pre-existing symptoms. Like for example, an individual or a client who is already having substance abuse disorder, who's been diagnosed, or post-traumatic stress disorder, or suicidal ideation, or vicarious trauma. How do we handle all of them? So it's very much necessary for all of them to get medication, if they need any medication, immediate medication, consulting a psychiatrist, and also having a clinical psychologist, it's very much necessary. Not to. And the different degrees of symptoms about this, he's talking about fatigue, breathlessness, described as many as hair hunger we talk about, and brain fog. We are having inability to concentrate sometimes, and having anxiety and depression. These are the symptoms, different degrees. Now, how do we do it? Having a structured family time, complete diversion from work. It's not like main kaam kar raha hu fir bhi main family ke saath spend kar raha hu. No, try to have a separation from your family time and your work time. Then you will be able to put your 100% of time to your family. You can show love and affection to your family, that you're caring and concerned. And also, your work should not be affected. Put your 100% effort to your work. So do not mix up again the same thing. Practicing mindfulness is very much important. Having a diary to express yourself, like today is a good day, today is a bad day, I felt good, I felt bad. Expressing about your own feelings is always helpful to make yourself strong, understand your own self. During the COVID, the psychological first aid has been more talked about. That again is about theoretical aspect. How do we do? What is it? Reflective listening, assessment, prioritization, intervention, and disposition. These are all been explained, been taken care, done in a very systematic way by a psychologist, clinical psychologist, or a psychiatrist. And I'm not going to talk about do's. I would not only talk about psychological first aid, what we should not do. Don't hesitate to ask about intention to harm self or others. Do not hesitate to ask specific questions about the person's ability to take care of others, children or other elders. Do not rush. Don't make promises which you can't keep up. Don't dismiss any concerns. And don't try to fix a problem with a simplistic solution. You need to find out it. And what has actually COVID pandemic is providing for all? Opportunity to healthcare planners, decision makers of government are able to understand what can be done for the disability population. Previously, when there was no COVID, the government is doing many aspects, but how to handle during the lockdown? Probably the private sectors, the government sectors, the NGOs are more going to work about on this. How to handle, how to take care of emergency lockdown during the future. And we also see about herd mentality, which is called as man down. And the everybody on the planet, like once lockdown time, everybody were going around buying things, shopping, groceries, everything. But this is not something abnormal. But how to manage is something which is very much necessary, because everybody is having fear, triggered about it, and they're worried about. But face masks and sanitizer are still available, but people are able to run here and there. So our country is actually facing it, how to handle it. And this is about WHO, which talks about the definition of healthy. How we define a person who is healthy? We have to understand the person is healthy in all the aspects, psychological, biological, social. These are the two recent Times of India newspapers which are talking about the COVID and the mental health aspects, and how the COVID symptoms affect our whole physiological aspect. What are the percentage? What kind of percentage of eyes we have? 17% headache we have. This is one of the research which are quoted. And during the lockdown time, what do? We need to learn self-compassion. It is important to give yourself the same support and compassion you give others. We sometimes, as a professionals, sometimes we forget that even we need to take care. We always think as a family member, बड़ों का ख्याल रखना है. We also have to understand that हमको भी ख्याल रखना चाहिए. So it's always about self-compassion. Acknowledge your emotions, pain and stress. A loving kindness practices helps reduce feelings of distress and burnout when caring for others. How do you practice kindness during the COVID? For example, you can talk to a child or an adult or anybody. May I or we or you think about trying to be free from fear? Can we be happy? Can we make a peace together as a home together? That's what something we need to practice and repeating for yourself. These are called affirmations which are going to help you. I can stay patient and kind with myself and others. My feelings are valid, but do not have to define me or overwhelm me. I'm doing the best I can in this moment, and that is enough. Repeat for yourself. This is really hard to accept pandemic, but I can't deny I'm struggling with this. I feel it could be sad, I feel hurt, I feel angry, I'm feeling whatever emotion. You have to accept the emotion and acknowledge the emotion and address it accordingly and try to resolve it. Remind yourself, you're not alone, you're struggling. You, me, all, the whole world is together fighting with COVID. But we all have to be positive. Everyone is having a hard time. We need to understand about it. And the paced breathing is something which you're going to talk about during how do we handle stress. We can't prevent stressful things from happening in our lives. Do our best to recover in the present moment. Anxiety passes easily from person to person, as so the calmness. We have to also spread calmness. Try to be calm during the COVID. Do not be in anxiety, or do not have a fear, or do not have any kind of negative emotion where any of your family member tries to take it, understands it, and feels the same. Carryovers. Research indicated paced breathing helps our nervous system remain calm while still allowing us to remain alert. And how do we do it? These are the few steps which I've given. First, notice when you start to feel tense or when you're holding your breath. Try to notice it. Make sure you take some slower, deeper breaths. Extend the exhale. Take a long, heavy sigh. You can also breathe in for 5 counts and out for 5 counts whenever rhythm naturally, it feels natural to you. You can think of a person, close your eyes, think of a person, activity, whichever makes you feel cool, happy, which makes you feel comfortable, whichever makes you feel good. You can also check the other things about how do you do this and paced breathing. You have videos also given. And any kind of flow discussions, I have given you my mail ID, I have given you my contact number. Thank each and everybody for patiently listening to this webinar. And I thank each and everybody who has worked hard to make the event happen right away, from even the technical team, right from the organizing team, everything. I thank, and these are the references I've quoted. Anybody interested can definitely ask. And so I hand over.
Ritvik sir, there is one question from the participant side, and that how do we differentiate between social and physical distancing?
Right. See, basically, what is that has been expected out of the government, that has been telling us to maintain a distance of 3 feet, like that, or two feet of like at least to 6 feet of distance, or even 3 feet of distancing. So this is basically to avoid the spreading of the virus. So that is what is the distancing that is the government is expecting. So that, okay, fine, you do not meet each other or personally do not have some kind of a close contact, so that virus doesn't spread. So it doesn't mean that we shouldn't talk to each other. So I am addressing, now I am talking to almost 46, 45 people over here. So this is, what we are doing is, so having a social communication. So now we are not talking about having a social distancing, but what is the government is expecting is about the physical distancing to avoid the virus spread. So that is the difference between how I differentiate between physical distancing and a social distancing.
Thank you, sir. And now I request to participants that please fill the feedback form, and so that the certificate of participation can be delivered. And I am now requesting Manish Kumar, please send the feedback link. And again, I'm requesting you to please deliver the vote of thanks to our respected and distinguished guest, resource person, and participants.
Thank you, sir. आज की इस विशेष संगोष्ठी पर मैं मनीष कुमार आप सभी भूतजनों को जो भी इस कार्यक्रम में उपस्थित हैं सभी को मैं सादर प्रणाम करता हूं। आज के कार्यक्रम में मुझे धन्यवाद ज्ञापित करने का अवसर प्रदान करने हेतु अपने निदेशक महोदय, अपने रेजिडेंट कोऑर्डिनेटर मैडम और प्रोग्राम कोऑर्डिनेटर मैडम का तहे दिल से शुक्रगुजार हूं कि उन्होंने यह अवसर प्रदान किया। धन्यवाद के क्रम को आगे बढ़ाते हुए सर्वप्रथम हम धन्यवाद करना चाहूंगा हम अपने यशस्वी निदेशक परम आदरणीय डॉक्टर हिमांशु दास सर का, जो कि NIEPVD देहरादून के निदेशक हैं। सर के कुशल मार्गदर्शन में CRC सिक्किम लगातार ऑनलाइन कार्यक्रमों के माध्यम से दिव्यांगजनों की सेवा, पुनर्वास, मानसिक स्वास्थ्य जैसे कई गंभीर विषयों पर अनुभवी एवं योग प्रशिक्षकों के माध्यम से कार्य कर रही है। सर आपका बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद। इसी क्रम में हम आज के कार्यक्रम के मुख्य वक्ता आदरणीय डॉक्टर सत्यनारायण गौडसे का तहे दिल से धन्यवाद देता हूँ। बहुत ही ज्ञानवर्धक जानकारी दिया सर के द्वारा, बहुत अच्छे अच्छे सभी प्रतिभागियों को जानकारी दी गई कि कैसे इस महामारी में हम दिव्यांग जनों को घर पर रहते हुए उनका मानसिक स्वास्थ्य को अच्छे से देखभाल कर सकते हैं। दिव्यांगों के लिए अच्छे अच्छे एक्टिविटी, आउटडोर गेम, इनडोर गेम के बारे में जानकारी दी गई। इन एक्टिविटीज को अनुकरण कर निश्चित रूप से जितने भी प्रतिभागी हैं दिव्यांग जनों के मानसिक स्वास्थ्य के देखभाल कर सकते हैं तथा उनके जीवन में उन्नत विकास ला सकते हैं। सर आपका बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद। इसी क्रम में आज के दूसरे मुख्य वक्ता आदरणीय डॉक्टर सित्विक एस कश्यप सर का धन्यवाद करना चाहूंगा। सर के द्वारा आज इस कार्यक्रम में बहुत ही ज्ञानवर्धक जानकारी दिया गया कि कैसे दिव्यांगजन अपने मानसिक तनाव को दूर कर सकते हैं। इस महामारी के दौरान वे सभी मानसिक रूप से मजबूत होकर महामारी का डटकर सामना कर सकते हैं। आदरणीय सर का बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद।
धन्यवाद।
इसी क्रम में आज के कार्यक्रम समन्वयक एवं वक्ता डॉक्टर तेनाली रजनी भूषण मैडम, जो कि सीआरसी सिक्किम के नैदानिक मनोवैज्ञानिक हैं, आपने मानसिक स्वास्थ्य को हम कैसे स्वस्थ रखें इस विषय पर प्रकाश डाला। मैम आपको भी बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद। मैं धन्यवाद करना चाहूंगा अपने सीआरसी सिक्किम के रेजिडेंट कोऑर्डिनेटर मिस आयरिस मैडम का। आपके मार्गदर्शन के बिना ऐसे कार्यक्रम का आयोजन करना मुश्किल होता है। आपके सहयोग एवं कुशल मार्गदर्शन हेतु आपका बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद। मैं धन्यवाद करना चाहूंगा आज के इस कार्यक्रम के सह समन्वयक विद्याभूषण सर, जो कि लेक्चर फिजियोथेरेपी हैं, तथा सीआरसी सिक्किम के समस्त अधिकारियों एवं कर्मचारियों का, जिन्होंने पूर्ण रूप से सहयोग देकर इस कार्यक्रम को सफल बनाने में हमारी मदद की। आप सभी को बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद। मैं धन्यवाद करना चाहूंगा इस कार्यक्रम के समस्त जुड़े प्रतिभागियों का, जिनके बिना यह प्रोग्राम सफल होना बहुत ही मुश्किल था। आप लोगों का साथ ही इस प्रोग्राम को सफल बनाया। आप लोगों का बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद। आप इसी प्रेम और इसी विश्वास से जुड़े रहें, जिससे हम लोग सीआरसी सिक्किम की ओर से ऐसे महत्वपूर्ण कार्यक्रम करवाते रहें और हम सभी का मनोबल इसी से बढ़ता है, आपकी सहयोग से, आपकी सहभागिता से। इसी आशा के साथ कि आप अगले कार्यक्रमों में भी इसी तरह से जुड़ेंगे, मैं सभी को सादर प्रणाम करता हूं और अपने वाणी को विराम देता हूं। धन्यवाद।